I'm going to the city and I'm gonna do a city show. And I know all my fans wanna learn how to make some dough. I've been cruising up and down for trains each and every night. And with my iPhone exciting, I know we're gonna get it just right. I'll get inside your mind, we'll have a real good time. We're gonna train today, we gotta train today. Go askSlim.
Hi, I'm Steve Miller. Call me Slim. And this is the Ask Slim Market Week. It's a look back at what happened in the financial markets in the past week, and a look forward at what might happen in the next week, and always some interesting things in the middle. Well, this week saw a tone change, and that was after 5 weeks of the stock market soaring on the upside, S&P 500 gaining 246 points in that period. And now, at this point, the market takes a rest. We'll call it a pause, as the market has a minor pullback. It all started out calmly, and then Tuesday, everything changed. The horrific news that came out that radical Islamic terrorists, three suicide bombers, killed 34 people in Brussels, wounding hundreds in this horrible, murderous action, and the markets overnight, well, they took a brief little spill, and then the stock markets just simply shrugged it off, as if investors are numb to all of this horrible terrorist activity that seems to be in the news constantly. And they see that what happens is that the market kind of drops off, and then before you know that, it the markets then recover. You look back at even at 9/11, it was far more dramatic and a far bigger break, and then the markets still had a recovery after that. So investors, they simply kind of ignore the effect on the stock market. But then things started to change again, as the fears of this kind of activity, more terrorist activity, started to put a worry into the markets that the Eurozone actually, which is very slow, might actually slow down even more. And what the terrorists couldn't do to the markets, then the dollar and commodities actually did do. It was kind of a chain reaction, as the potential slowdown in Europe brought a break in the euro and the British pound that boosted the dollar, and in this domino effect, commodities started to fall, and that, you know, broke gold, broke oil. Everybody follows oil as oil moved down from 42.50 down to about 38.50. The stock market then had some selling coming in. We expected corrections in gold and in oil and in the stock market, and they pretty much did what we expected. An interesting side note is that China, they let their yuan fall pretty dramatically, the most in months, really. And what I read, it's really a message to our Fed that said, don't raise those interest rates and boost the dollar. Dollar goes up, money comes into the U.S., and it's kind of a suck out of the other nations. And China says, we're going to let our currency fall. And that might make the Fed think about raising interest rates again. Fed heads, they're out talking it up, saying that rate hikes are likely coming soon. My guess is we get one more this year. I think it's politically motivated. Simply, they want to make the political left look responsible, and 'cause I think they all lean that way. So they want to get rates up, and I think they're going to have a hard time justifying rate increases. Let's take a look at what happened in this holiday-shortened four-day week in the stock market as we look at our E-mini calendar. That's a 24-hour E-mini chart, a 24-hour chart of the S&P 500 that has the news items on here, the things that actually did affect the market, caused some moves in there. Take a look starting out here on Monday. You can see that there was a little bit of sloppy action overnight. Eurozone stocks a little changed at all. When oil pops over here overnight, we get this move up in the E-minis as the market continuously follows the oil market. And then they give up gains overnight. You get another rally here during the day as the S&P 500 starts to hit that important resistance up around the 2053 area on the cash index. And overbought energy stocks, they started to pull back. And then this horrible news, the terrorist attack in Brussels, travel shut down, nuke plant evacuated as panic really hits. You get this break here in the market that you can see when the news hits, then it starts to recover, and then overnight, right here they start to get a little rally back, and big rally here as the S&P 500 pushes up past that 2053 number, but then starts to roll over again. Richmond Fed helped, the biggest gain in 23 years as manufacturing surges, it was certainly a choppy day. Now after that news, you can see there was a kind of a flat market overnight after Brussels. Everything kind of froze, but then the dollar started to strengthen right over here and commodities began to break, and as that oil starts to fall, you begin to get this fall decline in the E-minis right there, and that continued pretty much during the next day. Gold, oil down both over 2%. Gold and silver stocks get slammed, and U.S. stock market, we'll call it, just really modestly weaker. Then overnight on Thursday, right now the last day of the week, commodities remain weak. Gold was down over 3%, but then it did recover. The Eurozone gets hit pretty hard, though. All of this concern about slowing there, and all of the concern that, well, there's talk of many more terrorists out there planning attacks, and everything is just frozen. U.S. stocks were very weak from the opening, only down about a little more than 0.5% around midday. Energy and material stocks, they just continue to be on the weak side. And then, of course, Friday, the markets closed. Thursday, the bond market closes early. So this is the end of this holiday week. When we look at the calendar of what is coming up in the next week, you will see here in our earnings and economic calendar, few earnings reports coming out worth note. Lennar comes out Tuesday morning. Now, D.R. Horton, they reported this week a really good earnings, and the stock did well. On Wednesday, we get Lululemon before the opening, and then after the close, Micron. And then on Friday, this really struggling company of BlackBerry reports. A lot of news coming out during the week that kind of may be stacked up a little bit after the holiday week. Any big potential market movers, consumer sentiment can move the bond market, certainly. Then on Wednesday, we get the precursor to the big news on Friday, the ADP report, that is the private sector employment. And then on Friday, we get the, at 8:30 in the morning Eastern time, we get the employment situation, which is always a market mover. ISM can be a market mover also. So that is a look at the economic calendar for the week. That's it for our opening segment, and we'll be right back with the best and the worst of the week. When I bring the best of the week, what I bring is the biggest movers on the upside and also the best chart patterns. Opposite, of course, for the worst of the week. This week, 4-day week, but still had some nice movers, especially in stocks that had news. We're going to look at VA. VA is one of my favorite airlines. Man, do they do a great job. Their airlines are so much more comfortable. They have more room, more leg room, great TVs, and I just love everything about it. And now they're considering a sale of the company. Boy, I hope that doesn't wreck this company when somebody takes it over. Branson has done just a great job with it. Maybe that's why somebody is interested in buying it. Take a look here at this chart in VA. This one gains 13% on one day, 14% on the week. And you can see this nice gain. I don't have much in the way of analysis on it because it's a relatively new company, so haven't had any of our cycle patterns really forming in there. But you can see here this big upside week in there if they planning on selling it, then that big gain makes a lot of sense. I'm going to switch over to the daily chart in here because I want you to see that there has been an inverted head and shoulders that we were watching in there, and you could see that. And then on this big up day, it just breaks out in a big way. You could take a look there. The measurement is up to $36 on that. Those are those parallel lines to help you see. And there's your look at the inverted head and shoulders. Nice looking pattern in there in Virgin Airlines, and I'll be sad to see that one get bought out. SPLS, this isn't one that I bring very often. Staples, they're up 11% on the week. We'll take a look at this one in here as they get a big gain coming up to that resistance area about 11:30 on that stock. Some judge came out and criticized the FTC ruling that was blocking their merger with Office Depot. Good for you, judge. And that one gets a lift in there, 11% on the week. Schnitzer Steel is another one we'll look at, SCHN. This is in the group of steels that I follow. Don't trade this one very often. It's on the thin side. This one up 9%. And we'll take a look here at the daily chart in there, as there's a little bit of a pattern that is significant. And there you could see in there that good looking chart right there that is a pennant. We're going to look for another little pop on the upside in there, and that one looks to me like it's going to probably roll over shortly after that. I actually have been trading US Steel X on the short side, and I think one more pop in those and they're likely to roll over. Jefferies during the week has downgraded the group. A triple D, that's up about 7%. Take a look at that one on the daily. It has a classic evening star. I think that one is topping. Wynn Resorts, that's up about 5% on the week. And this one and LVS, Las Vegas Sands, both have come up to a major resistance. So we're looking for pullbacks in there. Federal Express, similar, 35% gain in there in Federal Express in this past five-week rally. Just an incredible move on the upside there. 4% gain on the week, and we think this one is up to a resistance area and beginning to roll over also. That's the best of the week, and we'll be right back with the worst. Worst of the week. Well, as oil and gold, they roll over, what typically happens is that because of leverage in their profitability, these things are a lot more volatile. So oil has a downtick during the week of say 42 to about 38, and the declines in this group are much bigger. Transocean, that's Whiting, WLL, and SDRL, Seadrill, those are down 17 to 20% on the week. They had some good pops, and now as we get oil correcting, these things really get hammered. Transocean, they came out and said that they see a soft market for rigs, at least for the next 3 years. So they're not all that optimistic out there. That had those stocks moving on the downside. Same thing for gold stocks, as they gave up a good amount of ground in there. ABX, GDG, That's Bear Gold and Gold Corp. They gave up about 8 or 9% on the downside, far more than Gold did. So did Newmont NEM. That's the one we'll look at in here because that's the one that we had as topping and had that in our rankings and setups as a stock that was had set up in a nice area for it to have a pullback. Take a look here as you look at that weekly chart in Newmont. You could see that it got that up to that red zone. That's where we have our intermediate resistance level right there. Trades up into the 28s. That comes very quickly up from 16. That is just an absolutely enormous move. And now we believe we're in this corrective period right here when you look at that cycle analysis. That should have it in this choppy moving area up and down all the way into May. That's a long period of time that we expected to be kind of giving us money on the short side in here as rallies fail in there. Take a look at what this failure looked like when you look on the shorter term chart, the daily chart. It was trading in this upward channel. It was giving multiple warnings that this 27 to 28 area was a problem, and then it breaks all the way down here to 24.5. During this week, big gap that you can see there. We'll kind of look for a move up here to about 26 and a rebound, maybe a little bit higher, but then ultimately we expect it to get down into this 22.5 to 24 area in Newmont over these coming months. So we're looking at probably a pretty good corrective period here that we're talking about in gold also. So that is a look at Newmont. Now in the solar category, really the big mover of the week, which I'm just taking off my list, it's not even worth mentioning in there, is Sun Edison, S-U-N-E. That is a company that is going bye-bye, it appears, trading all the way down now 38% to about $1.25. So that stock extraordinarily weak. Worth looking at though is Solar City, which also moved to the downside about 16% on the week, another big loser. We were anticipating another decline in there in Solar City, and you could see that in our analysis here. Our chart subscribers get these charts, and our forecast was that it falls down into this area one more time, probably under the 18 number, and you could see this red week right here, and then starting sometime in April being able to get a rebound. So this kind of last drop that we were looking for looks like it did start this week. I want to show a chart that did not have a big change. Nike had a big decline, and it kind of made it unchanged on the week. Their earnings, you know, were really okay, but they had a bad miss on sales. Now, this is the Nike pattern. Nike is giving you one of the best patterns for these 2 years that we ever show. What makes it a great pattern? Well, it's the stair-step upward move. Anytime you see green, yellow, and continuing in a long upside move, that just shows you that the trend is strongly on the upside in here. There's no question, of course, when you look at that. If you put on a linear regression channel, which I'm going to do right over here, you can see as we put this on here on this, how it just illustrates this big upside upward trend that you can see in here. Now, this is really a toppy look when you look at this here, as this is what we call a dark cloud cover. The cycle patterns in here, and you could see these corrective zones, that's where the yellow comes in. Well, we're about to enter one of them right in here. When you look at the gap here in Nike, and I'm going to switch this over to the daily chart on this news. That's why I bring it. This is a classic what we call bear kicker. It's gotten down to this minor support zone right over here, and we would expect maybe a little attempted rally from there. But basically what we believe is happening in here is that you can see this pattern right in here on the daily. We think it's going to get down under 60 and then maybe get some false rallies and then move to the downside again. But this bear kicker pattern is really a problem, and we think that that is giving some sign that the Nike move in here of all of this stair-step upward beautiful pattern that we have seen in here on this weekly pattern is coming to an end. And this actually could be a major top, and you could see a big head and shoulders in there with it now in the right shoulder forming in there. So that could be a sign of problems for Nike. I want to jump for a moment into the defense category. Take a look at another stock, General Dynamics, down about 4% on the week. You could see the way we have this projected as this cycle pattern has rolled over, and looks to us like it could be in some trouble all the way out through the summertime based on this pattern. And the bottom came just about on time. It rallied up to the resistance area. You can see this 34-week moving average, which isn't quite halfway up of this decline, and now rolling over. That is a bad sign. As Deutsche Bank downgrades this stock, you got to wonder when you look at these stocks in the defense category, what's going on in there? You know, they should be getting a lift based on all of this, of course, horrible terror attacks and the potential for rebuilding the defense, as the Republicans keep saying. So all of that money getting spent, right, should help them. But take a look here at Lockheed Martin. You can see that head and shoulders top forming in there. And when I switch over to the daily chart, there are serious warnings right here. You see these high waves and then this big down day right there. Gotta wonder, what is going on? There's something about this defense group that is unexplained at the moment. And I think that GD turning down, Lockheed Martin looking like it's turning down right there, says something. I think that group has got problems. Not sure why yet, but we may know soon. That's it for the worst of the week. And we'll be right back with our emails. Emails and tweets. Not a lot going on Twitter out there these days. Usually have a lot of people asking me about different stocks and stuff, but haven't had much. But emails, there has been a ton. Especially got a lot about some member videos that I recorded this week, specifically one that I did on style, strategy, and plan. That's one of my seven categories of videos. It's called Respecting the Trend and Benefiting from a Momentum. I do try to align my videos with market conditions, and I've certainly lived through how different market conditions can bring challenges. So I brought this video, and I knew that if I focused it on shorter term traders, swing traders, and especially strategic option traders that are always short puts and calls, you know, on both sides basically trying to capture the decay, that those are traders that were having issues in this kind of market. And sure enough, I hit some bullseyes on that and got some great responses. I brought a couple for example, and I really encourage those that have not seen the video to go watch it. I think it's really a good one. JR writes, he says, I just finished watching your style strategy segment on respecting the trend. I have to say, you couldn't have better tailored segment to address what's ailing me, he said. This segment alone would be worth the cost of a year's subscription, if not more. Fantastic advice. Thank you so much. Thanks, JR, and really glad to hear that it's helped you, and I know it's helped a lot of people. Matt wrote, and he said, I feel like you made that segment just for me. You eerily identified my struggle with Delta in strategic option trading. I get so frustrated with the engagement level needed to manage Delta. This video will help me relax and realize more. It's better to relax and pick quality, high probability setups. That's really what we encourage here. For peace of mind's sake, this video is exactly what I needed, and thanks. Got great emails from Wendy and Craig and many more out there. So thank you all, and so glad to hear it helped. Really encourage people to look in our member videos. Kyle writes me first, and he says, he sent me two charts on IBM. Kyle shares this chart with me, which I love, and said he sees a small short setting up and wants to know what I think. And truth is, I agree. There's a swing trade here likely coming on the downside, and it actually started on the Wednesday market when the market got a pullback. Take a look here at IBM. First, we will look at the weekly chart, And that's where I pretty much always start when I'm doing my analysis. There are cycles in here, and you could see these rhythms right here on these weekly charts. You can see really nice alignment. And then in this rising phase right here, it got into this resistance zone and started to fail. Note right over here where this cycle got into this resistance zone and then failed. This one here, the intermediate middle cycle, got to the resistance zone and started to fail. So IBM is at a spot where on the intermediate analysis, I do believe it's going to pull back. When I look at it here, this red area is that intermediate analysis on the daily chart. And the daily chart in here looks to me like it is starting to roll over. This pattern that we have here is called an evening star. That's the up day with the star and then the down day. It's also referred to as an inside down. That's the Harami right there, that star, and then the down day. So we're in what we believe to be this declining phase right over here in the cyclical patterns. That's suggestive of getting down into this support zone between 140, 141 down over here, which would be a nice little short side swing trade. So Kyle, I'm with you on that. I think it's a good one. Next one we get from Kenny S, and he says, JCPenney, WTF? He says, I bet against this dog and I bought a put. So far it isn't giving any ground. And he says, I totally agree with you, talking about me. It's almost worthless. Truth is that I've been extremely bearish on JCPenney. I think that the stock is going to go bankrupt at some point, company, and that we'll see it under $2 sometime. I said that last year, saw it go down from like the 14s down to single digits, and then got a bounce, as there's a lot of hope in here that it's going to get rescued. The problem is that a company like this, a brick and mortar company that cannot compete in this digital world, looks to me like they are going to have some serious trouble going forward. Here's JCPenney on the weekly chart, and I, you know, bearish or not, I stood aside because I saw that the pattern was turning to the upside. You could see right in here where this cycle was turning up and it gave you this big rally. Note the shooting star right over here, and as it's trying to roll over, stock, like I said, got down from 14 like a couple of years ago, all the way down to under 6 here, and then same place over here, down under 6. We'll see it down there again, and worse is my opinion. Anytime these companies start talking about, you know, their burn rates, which is really high for JCPenney, they had a good quarter. Well, they're supposed to have a good quarter during Christmas. Then here's the daily chart. You could see that M top and rolling over. By the way, the slim ribbon gave you the positive momentum signal right over here. You could see that arrow, and the stock explodes. Here's your engulfing pattern right here. Here's your double star evening star, and it looks like it's rolled over. So we'll have to see if this upside momentum that it has right now ends. And, you know, I think it's topping. I think you might get a little more pop on the upside. And I think, really, it's failing. Paul C. writes me, another one of my avid, great analysts and followers out there, and he says, Slim, the whole trading for a living thing, I've really never been into it. If you go to trader expos, trader education companies dangle this, you know, this lifestyle of being a trader to attendees as part of their pitch. He says, I know very few people who trade full time. And if you had a choice, would you like to see more people fit trading into their lives as opposed to making it their career? And are part-timers successful versus full-timers? If you actually asked me this question 20 or 30 years ago, Paul, I would have had a different answer for you. I wouldn't have hesitated actually for a second to say, even though this is a tough business, it's worth the risk to come in and give it a shot as a career. There was low startup costs, and the markets ordered tons of opportunity. But the world has changed since then significantly. Now the edge has been removed by the high-frequency traders, the dark pools, and the huge traders that, you know, have an advantage of knowing big orders that are coming in, and they might just have milliseconds or seconds, but it's enough for traders, and that has completely taken away the edge. Today, it's much more about rate of return, and the way to be profitable is through a combination of proper analysis, strategic approach, and risk management. It takes a lot of balance to be profitable. That's the when, the how, and the how much, really, as you approach the markets in a reasonable, educated way. So let's just discuss this for a second. Let's say a person has a nice account size, let's say $50,000, and trades really appropriately. If they do really well, they're good at it. You know, they probably can average 2-4% a month. Managing the money properly, figure there's 2 or 3 losing months in there. So they're probably on their 50K account make 15 grand. They've done really well if they do that in this world of 0% interest rates, for sure. So to make a living on that kind of rate of return, the amount of money somebody needs probably in their account is 300 grand, based on reasonable approach to the market. Now, an active trader that's got a very short-term style and is on top of the markets every single minute and really, really gets how to be a momentum trader in this market, because that's what it takes, well, they'll do better. And, you know, it takes less money to do it then. But you've got to be really on top of it and a full-time trader. And there are a very low percentage of people in that category. And that's an expensive way to trade, too, because commissions, even in this world, add up when you're just scalping for little tiny increments on these. So that's really the answer to your question, whether it's better to be full-time or part-time. Well, the answer is kind of both, but it takes a special person to be able to be a full-time trader and a person that's a part-time trader, and I think that's the vast majority of people. Well, they have to have the proper approach to the markets. Again, the when, the how, and the how much. Those are the important things. And it also brings up a psychological aspect when we think about this trading in the markets. The vast majority of people that are engaging in the markets, they're trading, they're managing their own funds, and they have a separate source of income to pay the bills. That's one of the key parts to this answer, is that if you're going to be a trader, it takes a while to accomplish being a trader, right? At being a successful full-time, it's a tough road for sure. And during that period, you really have to have some pretty substantial cash backing behind you. To make a career of it, as a sole source of income, it takes time to find that style that works for you, you have to have a big enough bankroll set aside. I'd say, you know, minimum of 6 months, but realistically it could be 2 years, without putting the pressure on yourself to be successful. The key thing, one of the greatest reasons for failure by traders, is because they can't pay the bills. They, you know, have a lot of pressure on them, and then trading becomes about paying bills. It's pretty hard to be successful when that is the case. Mark L. writes me and he says, what process do you use on a daily basis to follow moves in all of the stocks that you follow? 330 stocks plus futures ETFs, about 400 symbols. He says, I realize that you have RV and perhaps others doing some of the heavy weightlifting, but if it was just you, what process would that be? Do you pull stocks from your watch list into TOS one by one and get a visual on every single one of them and their movements? Do you create lists of stocks, he asks me. What are the ways for tracking and setting this up to do it? This is really a good question. Don't forget, RV and I have only been together for about 8 months now, so this is something that I've always done on myself. Really, what I do is I look at this stuff all day long, but I start out the day specifically looking at the best traders. That's our rankings and setups list, about 70 of them. I look at the weekly and daily charts. Then when the markets open, I look at the biggest movers, biggest point movers, biggest percentage movers. I look at all the charts. You see, I put notes on a lot of charts. And then I keep running lists. Stocks that are approaching areas that I want to buy, or stock that approaching areas that I want to sell. These are my high quality entry areas, and that's what we share on rankings and setups also. Then I look at those lists every day, look at those stocks, and I even sometimes set alerts in so that the system can just tell me when something has got to a level that I want to look at. So I use those alerts as kind of keeping stuff on the radar for me. Speaking of our charts and stuff coming on the radar, we're going to look at some of those coming up in our short-term view. Be right back. Before we get into the short-term view, don't forget, you can get all of our charts with all this very unique type of cyclical analysis by becoming a Level 4 member, and you'll get everything else that we present. Level 3 members get our rankings and setups, and Level 2 members, all of our 7 categories of videos. Level 1 members, that's this show and all the archives, so amazingly broad products that we bring here. Become a member and raise your odds of success. All right, for the short-term view, what we look at is only the daily charts, and we really put in the analysis that we do for our longer-term charts also, but we share our short-term charts, and they give a picture of how the intermediate patterns are shaping up and what we expect in the next week. Last week, well, it might have been our best week since doing this show. 90% accuracy is where we're going to put it, as markets pretty much followed what we expected. The only thing that was a little off was the bond market, but basically bullseyes on light crude, the euro, the S&P 500, and the gold market. So let's take a look at these short-term patterns and get a sense for what we think is going to come in the next week. Take a look at light crude. We expected it to roll over, get down into this area of support, down to about 39.20. It got a little bit below that and then recovered back. You could see that tail. Typically, you can see it tickled that 21 day moving average right there in the slim ribbon. That often happens and brings you another bounce. And you can see that the cycle pattern is suggestive of the fact that this is the whole completed pattern that you see right in here. It might get another little blip on the downside. We're going to call maybe a little downside test in here and then turn up during the week. We'll look for 40.40 to 40.90 in this upward test on the upside of that minor resistance. And then after that, we expect it to roll over again for a bigger correction. So we're going to look for maybe only a little bit more downside in here, a test up in that 40.40 plus area before rolling over. Next thing we're going to look at is the gold market /GC. And in here, we're going to see that we are looking for a little bit of further correction. We'll take a look here as we bring it in. Now, what happened in here was there was a significant number. We expected gold to roll over. We thought it would test up around 1287 area. If it didn't, it really only got up to about 1262 and then rolled over as we expected. We cautioned, if you took out the 1225, that it would set up a head and shoulders top, and that the longer correction that we expected would be in play. And you have that actually having occurred right now. So we're going to expect gold to have a down week. We think it'll try to bounce because we think the dollar will actually pull back a little bit. So you might get a little bit of a bounce right in here, an attempted rally, maybe back up to the neckline, but then roll over again as these patterns are all starting to push down, and this intermediate correction down to about 1180 or so that we're talking about, it kind of looks like it's in place when you see that head and shoulders top formed. There's the measurement of the head and shoulders down around, we'll call it 1180 to 1184 down over there, and we expect that to happen over a number of weeks. So this week we'll call gold an attempted bounce, but rallies fail, move back to the downside. The next one we'll look at is /6E, which is the euro currency. We expected it to go into what we call the modest correction. It got help, of course, as this fear of slowdown in the eurozone took hold, and we expected it to get down to somewhere between supports of 1180 and 1115. That's this support zone right over here, and you can see it got right into it there. Now, what are we expecting in here? Well, like we said, we think that the dollar is going to give back some of those gains, and we expect a bounce in here in the euro currency. We're going to look for an up week that fails, similar to what we're looking for in the gold market, potentially getting up to this minor resistance level right over here. We'll call that 112.70 to 113 in there, and then take over again. This is a lot. There's a lot of correlation between the euro and the gold market because they both go inversely to the dollar. So this lines up pretty well with that minor attempted at rally in there, and then rolling over again. The bond market, /ZN, we look at the 10 years when we do our short-term analysis in here normally. What we expect in here was that, or we expected, was that we'd get up to about 129.20 and then fail in the next 1 to 2 weeks. That's what we said last week. You see we move sideways and choppy in here. We got up about 5 ticks from where we expected it to, and just hasn't had the time to roll over yet. So we're only going to give ourselves half credit on that one. If we gave ourselves full credit, it would have been 100% weak for us, and we don't want to have to top 90. So we'll just stay with a 90%er. We actually think that there's a little more time in here. We're going to look for a little bit of a down week in here, maybe chop around, give up some more ground. We're still looking for 127.29 as the testing support area. After that, the intermediate term pulls up, and all of this short-term stuff finishes on the downside. And we will expect some stronger rally in there for a few weeks. So that is a look at the bond market. Now, for the stock market, we had expected that 2053 in the S&P 500. The last couple of weeks, we talked about that area as a confluence of resistance in the S&P 500. And we thought last week, we said, well, it looks like it might pop through it on the upside and then begin to roll over or fail if it tried to do that. That is exactly what happened. And it corrected down to this week, what would have been the first support area that I would have expected, a perfect touch of the 13-day moving average. Don't quite think it's over yet on the downside when we look at this. So here is the S&P 500. You see that confluence, as we call it, of resistances at the 78.6%. It popped up through it one day, 2 days by a little bit, and then rolled over. That's what we expected there. We're still what we consider to be still maybe between 4 and 6 days from the end of this corrective period right in here. You see the touch here of the 13-day moving average on the slim ribbon. Slim ribbon turned positive momentum-wise right there, and then you've had that whole rally. Now, what we expect in here for the next week is that, you know, we're just going to call it, you know, I said maybe 4 to 6 days. That feels a little long to me based on this, but we'll say maybe up to 4 days of correction in here. This is our target, 2010 that we talked about last week, and we think it'll get down around over there and then turn up again, as you can see we have drawn in here. Here's where that cyclical pattern does that. Then we think that we get another test over the 2050 area and see how good that area there is of resistance. So we're going to call most of the week choppy lower, attempted rallies maybe fail, gets down like this, and then gets that upturn that we're looking for right there. All in all, this is likely to be only a minor correction in this huge up move that we've had. That's just the way these patterns are shaping up, and I know I'm looking for bigger declines out there, but I have to follow these shorter patterns, which give us such strong messages. When I look at the VIX did exactly what we expected in this week. We thought that the stock market would roll over, and that was based on the fact that we thought this VIX upturn was coming, the implied volatility upturn. Now, this, you know, has a few more days potential in it, and that lines up with a few more days on the downside in the stock market. But then after that, you get, you know, what could be a week and a half or 2 weeks of decline. We're going to think that we get a top in here, you know, in this 15, 16 area in implied volatilities, and then come back down to 14 over that week and a half or 2 weeks. That's where that next stock market rally likely comes. And after that, the intermediate pattern turns up sharply. I don't normally share this. I save this for members. But you can see in here what this looks like on the weekly chart. Implied volatilities are due in the next couple of weeks to have a sharp upturn. That's where I see the next big correction in the stock market. And that's why I believe, one of the reasons I believe that we're going to get this failure in this area of this 2050 or a little higher in the S&P 500, and then into some bigger correction again. That remains to be seen, and in the meantime, we're looking for only modest correction, and then a rally again. That is it for the show this week. I hope you have loved the information. I hope I can bring as good of a accountability next week on my short-term calls. And essentially, all I do is say what the charts are saying, and hopefully you've had an opportunity to profit on that. That's what we're looking for, is raising your probabilities of success. That is it for this week. We hope it's a great holiday weekend for you, and I am always wishing you great trading.
Well, I'm going to sit down.